Members, we have formed a quorum. It's time to get started. I now call to order the meeting of the panel on manpower. First item, confirmation of minutes of the previous meeting. Members, any question about the minutes? The Secretariat hasn't received any proposed amendments, so can I confirm the minutes? Agreed? Okay, minutes confirmed. Second item, information issues since last meeting, and there's only one, and on the 2nd of December 2016, Mr. LUK Chung-hung sent a letter to the Secretariat requesting the panel to discuss the comprehensive review on employees' compensation system, including the scope of the employees' compensation ordinance and the matters relating to a central insurance and compensation fund. But actually, this is already in the list of outstanding items for discussion, and let's hope that we can bring it up for discussion within next year. Next item, items for discussion, a date of next meeting and items for discussion. Please refer to the list of outstanding items for discussion. The next meeting will be held on the 23rd of January, that's a Monday, at 8:30 a.m. The starting time is different. Please note the change of our meeting time. We'll be having a briefing by the Labour and Welfare Bureau and also the Education Bureau on the 2017 policy address in respect of policy areas related to manpower. And the Education Bureau will also be briefing us on the implementation of qualifications framework. So two items, one from the LWB, the other from the Education Bureau. Comments, members? If not, we can now move on to the next item. Adjustment of the levels of compensation under Employees' Compensation Ordinance, the Pneumoconiosis and Mesothelioma Compensation Ordinance, and the Occupational Deafness Compensation Ordinance. This is the discussion item for today's meeting. Let's invite the officials to join us before we start. Please invite the officials to come in. Members, please refer to paper CB2 4816/16/17(3). Welcome to government officials attending our meeting for this item. Mr. Carson Chan, Commissioner for Labour, over to you for introduction before we start our discussion. Thank you, Chairman. I will highlight proposed adjustment of the levels of compensation under the ECO, the PMCO, and the ODCO. There were 18 compensation items involved. Under our standard mechanism, we would look at objective data every 2 years and make adjustments to the levels of compensation under the three ordinances. The purpose is to make sure that workers suffer from occupational diseases and families of workers who die arising from their occupation. Well, the new compensation would take effect on the 6th, has already taken effect of the changes since the last exercise on the 5th of March 2013. We'll look at CPI or wage movements, depending on the nature of the compensation items. If it's related to earnings, we will look at the nominal movement of the nominal wage index. Is it about purchase of service or consumables? We look at the movement of CPI. In 2014 and 2015, by referring to the relevant information, we propose to adjust the amounts of a total of 18 compensation items under three ordinances. In the light of the movement of nominal wage, there were 5 items under ECO and 2 items under ODCO. Altogether, 7 will be adjusted by 8.78% upward. As for the adjustment made with reference to the price movement as reflected by CPIA, we would like to propose adjustment to 3 items under ECO, 4 items under PMCO. They will be adjusted by upwards by 9.8%. And we have also made reference to the adjustment made to the benefits provided by the CSSA and so the minimum monthly earnings under ECO to be taken into account in the adjustment will increase by 10.84%. And also we are going to propose an adjustment for the care and attention of home suffering from pneumoconiosis by 5.68%. 10 of the items will be adjusted in accordance with our established mechanisms. As for 2 items, starting from this time, they will be adjusted by referring to CPIA. That is the first allowance for purchasing of hearing aid and the total amount of compensation payable under the PMCO.
We have submitted the proposals for discussion last month by the discussion of the LAB, and the LAB unanimously agreed to such proposals and asked that such proposals be submitted to the electrical as soon as possible for scrutiny so that the proposals can be implemented as soon as possible, so that compensation can be made to the affected employees as soon as possible. So that's why we are reporting these proposals to the Manpower panel. We hope to get your support. We hope that we would introduce the legislative amendments to the LegCo in the first quarter of 2017, and we hope to implement the proposals as soon as possible. So much for my presentation. Now, this is subject to negative vetting, is that right? Positive vetting? In other words, well, that will be passed by the LegCo if we don't set up a subcommittee to look at the subsidiary legislation. All right. 2 members would like to ask questions. We have ample time today. Each member will be given 5 minutes. The first one is Mr. Poon Xiaoping, followed by Mr. Michael Luk, and Mr. Jonathan Ho and Jeremy Tam. So Mr. Poon Xiaoping and also Dr. Fernando Zhang. Mr. Poon, thank you, Chairman. I welcome these proposals and the adjustments. I would like to understand more. We know that for the ECO, that is really for dishing out compensation for deaths and also employees suffering from permanent total incapacity. Now, looking at Annex 1, the monthly wage will be increased from 26,000 to 28,000. So in other words, there will be an upward adjustment of $2,290. In the last Manpower panel meeting, we know that in the first half of 2016, 9 people died while they are doing work, and 6 of them are from the construction field. And for the construction sector, the wages are like this. If you talk about form work worker, the bar bender, their daily wage is 2,500 and 2,100 respectively. So that means a monthly pay of over $50,000. I'm sure that they would be earning a salary higher than the ceiling allowed. So would you consider raising the wage ceiling for these sectors? Please increase the levels. Has the government got information on what happened in the past 2 years? Say, if there are deaths of workers, how many cases of the workers who are earning this ceiling of $26,070? Do you have such information, Commissioner? Let me set out the major principle first. For the compensation mechanism, we are not tailoring it to for meeting the needs of specific sectors. We will have an overall picture. And for the statutory compensation, it is a no-fault system, and it will be shouldered by the employers and the sector. So even if an employee died, not because of the fault on the part of the employer still has to shoulder the compensation responsibility. So we have to take that into account, and we have to have regard to the overall economic situation of the society. We should not be just looking at, say, a specific sector, say, the construction industry, where the wages are relatively high and higher than the ceiling of $28,360. I think we have to have regard to the overall picture. Let me supplement. Well, we would be calculating the compensation based on the last monthly salary. So in other words, if the difference is too big, the gap is too wide, then the compensation is not enough for the worker, the affected worker. Now, in the past 2 years, in terms of the construction workers dying while they are working, so is it the case that their salary is lower than the $26,000, or is it higher? Well, it's not just the construction sector. For some other sectors, the wages have increased. Does the government need to review the ceiling here, Commissioner? We are talking about the compensation under the ECO. This is a statutory compensation level. Now, for any specific case, in certain cases, the employees can make claims under the common law in the court. And for the majority of the death cases, the cases will be handled and ruled on by the court. And under the common law, the court will not be constrained by our proposed ceiling. Now, in response to Mr. Poon's question, in 2015, for the resolved cases, there are 59 deaths, and of these, 11 of them relate to workers who are earning a salary above the ceiling. And for most of these cases, they will be ruled upon by the court, and the income will not be a major factor considered. And for the last monthly salary, now, under the ECO, not only that will be taken into account, but the salary for the past 12 months will be taken on board as well, so that the last monthly salary will not affect the compensation too much. Would you be reviewing the ceiling? Because it's been a long time since you did the last review. We will be going by the established mechanism to adjust upwards the ceiling. Now, when will, well, how very often do you review the mechanism? Well, we would look into that again. And for this time, we'll be going by the established mechanism. And I think we've done what is appropriate. Mr. Michael Lok. Thank you, Chairman. Will the government consider relaxing the scope under the ODCO? Because in many work trades now, the workers' hearing ability is adversely affected. They're not covered under the ordinance. And for some workers, they have to wear pagers and also the all the time. For example, the restaurant workers, the security guards, and also those working in the betting centers and so on. They have to be subject to the impact of high-frequency noise. For example, the bus captains, they would be hearing the beeping sound from the octopus machines. So, and also the airport workers, and also the cleaning workers for aircraft and so on. So they may be affected. So will they be covered under the ordinance and also for the ECO? It doesn't cover workers who suffer from musculoskeletal diseases or disorders. And also we are concerned about the medical expenses. Well, the last time that was adjusted was 13 years ago in 2003. And now the ECO is just having a $200 medical fee every day. That's very disappointed. That's very disappointing. I think the figure is out of touch with reality. Whether you are visiting a bone setter or a Western medical practitioner, the amount is grossly insufficient, not to mention that you may also have to visit a physiotherapist and occupational therapist as well. The government's thinking is that the worker is expected to visit a public clinic, but then you have to make an appointment for government clinic, and you can't make an appointment today usually. You can only make an appointment for tomorrow. And the consultation or the doctor may not necessarily suit their needs. So shouldn't the patients be given more choices? Including the private clinics, shouldn't you be also considering the rise in the consultation fees in the private sectors? So this is something that the workers are facing every day. Now, two questions, ODCO and also the $200 claim compensation. The With regard to the ODCO, the Labor Department will review based on the established mechanism in 2003. We have amended the ODCO to cover more work trades which are subject to high-frequency noise. We are regularly reviewing the ordinance every now and then. As for the consultation fee, going by the established mechanism, we would take into account the fee charged by public hospitals under the HA, and we will review the fees accordingly. The HA, well, since 2003, there has not been any adjustment in the consultation fee. Say in the future, if the HA adjusts the fee in the future, we would be happy to adjust the fee or the compensation accordingly. Mr. Michael Lok, two follow-up questions. You said that For the ODCO, the last review was done in 2003. It was 13 years ago. And in the interim, what has the government done? Well, maybe this is the first time that I'm raising this at the Leisure Court, but then previously, the labor representatives on the Leisure Court have made repeated requests, similar requests. How come that you haven't considered their views? And also the consultation fees. We query why the government, I mean the Labour Department, is just looking at the fee charged at the public hospitals. Do you think that all people should just consult public hospitals and not private clinics? Well, Commissioner, do you consult the public hospitals all the time yourself and not the private practitioners? In 2003, we amended the ODCO and we've designated four more trades to be covered under the ordinance. These cover workers working in the abattoirs or near places nearby, and also workers working in the Mahjong Palace, and also disc jockeys of and discos, and also waitresses, bartenders near the disc jockey stations. So these are the four additional trade types added. Now, the Labour Department has time and again been watching closely the situation, and we've studied also workers in the games parlor, and also those working near the toll stations of cross harbour tunnels, and also those working in pager stations and so on. We have studied the work environment of these workers, and we have also conducted scientific noise study. But then the data available show that these workers are subject to the prescribed limits as provided under the ODCO. And, well, this is a very scientific term. Now, if the people are exposed to a noise level of 90 decibels for 8 hours a day, then that will meet our criterion. We have used that yardstick to measure the workers that I just mentioned, but then they haven't been able to meet this 90 decibel criterion.
So you may think that there has been little improvement, but as the commissioner said, things are kept under review. What about medical expenses? Would you just be considering HA fees and charges? Well, there's a question of balance. That is the expenditure on the part of the affected employee and the ability to pay by the employer. We have been referring to HA fees and charges. We believe $200 is adequate. But of course, the HA will be adjusting the fees and charges for the A&E department or specialist outpatient clinic. We'll be paying attention to the adjustments. But if you want to turn to the private sector medical fees, it's difficult to come up with a standard. And our public sector healthcare system is a very well-established one. Deputy Chairman, the current ECO was enacted in 1953, and there have been some amendments over the years, but the compensation levels are inadequate. Would there be a comprehensive review in the coming few years covering common industrial accidents and common occupational deaths such as muscular wear and tear and death arising from overexertion at work, if you will please tell us the timetable. If not, then why not? But in respect of death from overexertion, there was a discussion recently in this council, and the secretary has promised to conduct a study into Hong Kong's situation. Not many jurisdictions around the world have legislated on overexertion, but because it's very difficult to pinpoint the cause of death of an employee is due to overexertion. It's not going to be easy, but we have promised to collect local data to assess the situation. If necessary, we would take follow-up action based on the data collected. Commissioner, are you going to comprehensively review the ECO? Well, we are responsible for many pieces of legislation. We would review them from time to time to see whether we should take any follow-up action. But for a comprehensive review of the ECO, that would be a major exercise. And at present, ECO can be updated to keep up with recent developments so that appropriate compensation can be provided to affected employees. We will regularly review the adequacy or otherwise of compensation levels. Commissioner, on various occasions, the FTU has expressed concern about the rehabilitation of injured employees. Well, we are paying compensation to injured employees, but we are not doing sufficient to assist them to rehabilitate. The first 6 months after injury will be the golden period for rehabilitation. In Taiwan, apart from compensation, more would be done in respect of rehabilitation and occupational therapy. So can you do more apart from paying compensation to help the injured employees to get well soon or to acquire new skills within a specified time frame? Would you do this to further assist affected employees? An injured employee can make use of the various rehabilitation services offered by the HA on top of treatment. They have a physiotherapy services and occupational therapy services for injured employees. So the HA provides a full spectrum of services depending on the clinical conditions and the seriousness of the injury to make sure that the injured employee would get a proper treatment. Assistant Commissioner, let's say if it's about occupational deafness and the employee cannot hear anymore, apart from getting the compensation, can the Labor Department also help them to acquire new skills or to try to secure new jobs? Would you be offering assistance along that line? Well, after rehabilitation, we also help the employee to re-enter the job market. It's part of the rehabilitation process, but at present, it's not part of the compensation system. In other countries, they will offer a series of services under the social welfare system. And at present, we don't have any plan to incorporate such services under the employee's compensation system. We are in liaison with the HA. We understand the HA is offering a host of services to help employees. Are you going to have a review or a study of the ECO? Do you have a timetable? Well, previously, the Labor Department and other departments as well did not collect such data. If we have information of fatalities work-related cases, so we will try to collect information whether the employees worked for very long hours and also before the death. Did the employee work excessively long overtime? So we have to collect the data. We will try to get the data from the company and from the family. But we need to expend a lot of efforts to collect the data, because these data will not be reported to us automatically. We need to collect, say, data for the period in the past 3 years to see whether there is any relationship between overexertion and death of an employee. Mr. Tam Man Ho, I want to ask a question about the assistance for the purchase of hearing assistive devices. The total financial limit will be increased from 36,000 to 50,000, and for the first purchase is 15,000. It said that the assistance would be enough for procurement most devices available. What's the time frame in respect of the total financial limit from 36 to 50,000? Is it for an indefinite period of time? So if you lost your hearing at an early age, the total assistance given will still be 52,000. The understanding is correct in respect of the total or aggregate financial limit, but the limit will be subject to a review every 2 years. We will make sure that the limit would be able to catch up with the movement of prices. As for the hearing assisted devices, they are electronic devices, and prices have become more affordable lately. We believe the current level of compensation will be sufficient. So to me, the limit of $52,000 is not very meaningful. The hearing assisted device will have a usable life of, say, 5 years. And if the employee is, say, 40 years of age, and he will die, say, at 80 years of age. So can the financial limit be sufficient to enable him to procure the devices continuously? First of all, we have consulted the Occupational Deafness Compensation Board over the level. So at least to the board, the limit will be sufficient. And there is also the need to maintain the hearing assistive device, and we have collected the data. If you have to replace an old device, well, it's technical. We suppose a device can be used for 3 years. So on average, a device costs more than $10,000, so it's $3,000 odd per year during the 3 year life. So it's about $60 for maintenance, or $760 for maintenance. But this is what we have obtained after from the Occupational Deafness Compensation Board. We have also provided $400 for batteries, and also the device have to be serviced by the dehumidifier. So altogether, it would mean some $600 per $6,000 per month per year. So if it's $6,000 a year, then the 50,000 would mean that the limit would be reached in 9 years or less than 9 years. What was your estimated duration? Well, it's about $6,000 per year. I thank the department for telling us the figure. 50,000 means it's under 10 years. What would happen if the need lasts for more than 10 years? Ms. Pat, let's talk about the current level. There are two tiers for hearing assistive devices. For first-time applications, it's $15,000 at present. We propose to increase in $16,470, and the total financial limit is at present $52,000. We propose to increase it to $57,170, and our benchmark is with the movement of CPIA. And we also make reference to the experience of the ODCB in implementing the scheme. The last adjustments were made in 2015, and it was set at 15,000, and the total financial limit, aggregate financial limit, 52,000. If we look at the current limits, for 2014-2015, the affected claimants could not utilize the full amount. I know that there will be more and more people reaching the ceiling a few years later. So why don't you increase the limit every year, say 15,000, then 17,000, and then you tell them the maximum amount to be claimed every year is 50,000, and then it would be 80,000, 100,000. It would be alarming to employers. So why don't you provide for annual increases?
Dr. Fernando Zhang, Chairman, this is really a matter of formality. The compensation level will be adjusted once every 2 years. But then, this biannual review lags behind the price movement. Those who are injured at work and who died at work, and this presents difficulties to these people and their family members. We've said many times here that there should be an annual review. You are just adjusting it based on the CPIA and also some CSSA standards. These other indicators are adjusted annually. So you do have the information to help you with your review. You don't have to do anything extra. I don't see any excuse for not doing this on an annual basis. So this is number one. Number two, you are just covering basic items like consultation fees, basic living allowance, and also hearing assistance devices and so on. They are being very miserly. They are just using the CSSA standards. They are just providing the basic, the very minimum level. And in terms of rehabilitation, we are not asking a foreign domestic helper to help with the rehabilitation process. These people need treatment and rehabilitation services, and they often have to pay extra. And they can't just rely on the public hospital systems because there is always a long queue. So I have to make this repeated request, and that is the compensation scope should also cover rehabilitation and also care services. That's number two. Number three, there is this ECO, and also the certain compensation amount would be given out. But then the Labor Department is just the middleman here. It doesn't have any statutory power to ensure that the employers will comply with the ordinances. Say if the employee is injured, the only thing that the employer can do to evade the responsibility is to challenge that the injury was made during work. So we are seeing all these disputes, and also, the notaries and insurance companies will be involved in these disputes, and very often it takes 2 to 3 years before statutory compensation is dished out. In many overseas jurisdictions, they have a central employee compensation fund, and the employees and do not have to chase after the employers and also the insurance companies in those cases. So I've made 3 points, including setting up a central compensation fund. Let me respond to point number one first. The adjustment is based on objective data, including the nominal wage index and also the CPIA. After we collect the information and do analysis, we still have to consult the relevant committees, including, for example, the ODCB, the Pneumoconiosis Compensation Fund Board, and also the insurance sector. And then we have to submit our proposals for vetting by the LAB. So it takes time for us to compile the data and also consult the relevant bodies. And after that, we have to do legislative amendment as well. So we believe that the review is now being done once every 2 years. It's appropriate because we have to collect data. Well, I think these are all excuses, Chairman. You've got the established mechanism. You are just consulting the REM bodies as a matter of formality. I don't believe that the LAB will object to your proposals. I think it's just basic that we should have an adjustment on an annual basis. Rehabilitation and also a central fund. We do have this mechanism, but it's not the case that all items will follow the adjustment in the CPIA and also NWI. In 2003, we increased the assistance for the hearing assistant devices by 44%. So we will make exceptions sometimes, but overall speaking, we will be abiding by the NWI and CPIA. Now, with regard to rehabilitation, under the ECO, the medical fee should already have covered the rehabilitation services. But then again, of course, our assumption is that the employees will be using the patronizing the public hospital services, and we think that by that our amount is appropriate. The third question raised by the member is that whether we should establish a central fund. Now, if there are disputes between employers and employees, will the Labor Department also act as mediator? Now, if there are disputes, our usual practice is that the Labor Department will conduct an in-depth investigation, and we will look at the information provided by both sides, including the details of the accidents, the number of sick leave days. We would also be obtaining medical reports from medical institutions. We will try to ascertain whether the accidents arise out of the course of employment. We will not just blindly believe in what the employers say. Now, the Labor Department has also our own doctors who will give us independent advice. And we would also relay the advice to the employers and the employees as well. The Labor Department will also give our stance on work injury cases. Now, in many of the cases, after we've given our expert advice to the employers will then seek further advice from their insurers, and they ultimately, many of them will accede to our advice. Now, in 2015, we have handled 50,000 work injury cases, and 669, around 1.3% of the cases, have to be referred to the courts or to the legal aid department. And 98% of the cases have been resolved by the Labor Department. Maybe we'll have to go after them for the next in the next meeting. Well, that's not fair what he said. Well, for the 98% or so of the cases that he mentioned, that while the employees are just unwillingly giving up the case, well, the cases have not been resolved, Mr. Lam Kwok Hong. Well, please speak to the mic. The employees may lose their capacity to work, and the government is drawing up the limits based on the CSSA level. While CSSA is often termed as the last safety net, workers work and they make profits for the employers, and they get injured. But then, and then you're putting them into this safety net. Is it the case that the employers are not willing to pay more? How do you come up with this level or yardstick? Is it the case that the employers say that they should go back to and seek help from the CSSA scheme? Or do you think that this is an appropriate mechanism? Mr. Mack, let me explain. Well, there may be some misunderstanding. It's not the case that we are following the CSSA. Among the 18 items, one item relates to the minimum monthly wage, and our established practice is that we would take reference from the single and able-bodied adult under the CSSA, and also we would add in the other allowance, include rent allowance, water charges allowance, etc. Now, if a low-paid worker gets injured, that will be the minimum standard for him when he gets injured. And this amount of $3,000 also applies to part-time workers and also workers who are earning less than $3,000 per month. Well, I heard what you said. Well, we said that the barbenders and the form work, timber work workers, they are earning a high salary. And we should be giving out more compensation to them. But then you said that should not be the case because you will go by the laws. So how come that you are using CSSA as a standard? You reviewed last time in 2014, and you are reviewing it based on the nominal wage index, CPIA, and also welfare benefits under the CSSA scheme, and also the monthly wage and food allowance for a foreign domestic helper, etc., etc. Well, I'm not framing you. You are using these four standards, right? Don't you agree that you are just adopting the very minimum standards? So which paragraph are you referring to, member? Mr. Mack? Well, which paragraph are you referring to? In 2014, you did a review based on certain standards, and you said that you are also going by the court ruling on the PSLA in coming up with the latest standards, blah, blah, blah. Mr. Jeremy Tam asked a question about the occupational deafness, and you said that you are also going by the same principle in coming up with your calculation. And say somebody died and or was permanently incapacitated, you said that because this is no fault system, then you are paying the compensation at a level lower than what the person is actually earning. Mr. Mack, you're referring, are you saying that we should not take reference from CSSA? We should raise it, right? Well, yes, you should increase it. I think it's a result of the discussion at the LAB. You said that this is provided under the law, and so sorry for the bartenders, the formwork workers. Well, because we are going by the same yardstick, so we can't compensate you more. So when you talk about these three types of compensation, you should go by the same standard. And how come that you are adopting the minimum standards? Why did I say so? If you don't innovate your system and establish a central insurance fund and has every employer contributing to this pool, then you won't be able to resolve the problem. So this is exactly what we are suggesting. I think he has answered your question. I tried to explain my rationale here. If you don't set up a big pool, you won't be able to resolve the issue. I think they have hurt our views. In other words, put simply, well, all employers in Hong Kong should contribute a certain percentage out of their profits to contribute to this pool. Yes.
Well, this has been a perennial subject. Let's continue next time. Mr. Kwok Wai Kong. Well, if we just confine ourselves to the paper, there's nothing to argue about. You have calculated the adjustments in line with inflation and the changes or movement of CPI. But as other members have said, these ordinances have been around for a long time, and the Labor Department thinks that they're okay. And every time, they will just make the adjustments in accordance with the established mechanism. Is that a mitigation of the lack of initiative on the part of the government? As those patients suffering from pneumoconiosis have said, as they advance in age, they have to get consultation more and more frequently, but has the Labor Department done anything to help them more? Or is it that you make no preparation and for improvements, and you just stick to the status quo? If you have done something, tell us what. And if not, then tell us the constraints that you are subject to. As Mr. Mack has said, this biennial review is not just about looking at the movement of wages or inflation. For some compensation items, we'll have regard to the special circumstances and make higher adjustments. For example, we have done this for occupational deafness and for burial expenses from 2009 to 2011. We make a drastic adjustments upwards from 32,000 to more than $70,000. It's more than 100% in increase. So we had regard to the actual increases in cost. So it's not something that we do mechanically in each review. If necessary, we can make a bigger adjustments. Well, you can see where the problem lies. For very expenses, they are willing to make a bigger adjustment because it's one-off. You can't claim the burial expenses twice. But for other living expenses, which are more long-term in nature, they won't touch those. So you understand where the problems lie. Have all the problems been resolved by increasing the compensation on burial expenses or funeral expenses? But what about those who are still living? Shouldn't you do more to help them instead of offering help with their funeral? Although you say you are flexible, there are some basic principles underlying the biennial review, and we believe that this biennial review mechanism should itself be reviewed. So members have asked questions on this. Do you have any further response? Thank you, Chairman. As we have answered some previous questions, this is not a routine matter. It's not just adjustments made in accordance with data. We would keep things under review and to see if a bigger adjustment should be made. For example, following the last big adjustment for funeral, we have not stopped. It's now more than $80,000 now. Well, if it's something like a routine adjustments, we don't need to give them a time slot for a discussion. Let's wait until they have a bigger or more drastic increases. Well, we are offering advice to you on what should be covered, what more should be covered. For example, people suffering from deafness have told me that they're suffering from pain, but there's nothing, no compensation is provided to them for pain and suffering, unlike those suffering from pneumoconiosis. So can this be covered? That's point number one. Point number two, there is a note or there is a lack of sufficient representation for workers in the ODCO. Can more work workers' representatives be appointed to the board? And also, can adjusted compensation levels be applied retrospectively to previous cases? And also, the $200 for medical expenses is insufficient. Many, very often, they will have to top up for the shortfall. As to how we can make allow them to have private medical treatment, perhaps we can consider a voucher system. Commissioner, we've heard the members' input is valuable. Let's hope that you will be coming back with positive responses. Dr. Fernando Zhang, the whole system needs a comprehensive revamp on medical expenses. The HA is going to increase the A&E fee to the $220, and similarly, fees and charges for other services will be adjusted upwards. So would you make corresponding increases? Well, this is a biannual review, but very soon, perhaps next year, the HA is going to increase the fees and charges. As I've said, if HA really increases the fees and charges, then we'll look at whether there's a need to adjust individual items. So you won't wait until the end of another two-year period. Well, if there are such adjustments by the HA, we will consider doing it. Well, now the HA has already announced that they are going to increase the A&E charges to $220, so it would exceed $200 definitely. I think we are flexible. We are not saying that the next review must wait for another 2 years. We will take appropriate action to follow up if HA increases fees and charges. Yes, so please act quickly, because if you legs are far behind, the pressure on the affected workers will be very big. All right, we can now move on to the next agenda item. To follow up on the lapsed Employment Amendment Bill 2016. Please invite the next team of government representatives to join us. This is about a legislative item. All members of this council have been invited to attend our meeting for this part. The paper is CB248-1670-05. Over to you, Secretary. Maybe I can have to say more about the background for the benefit of new members. There was some in-depth discussion of the bill at the last stage. There were a number of CSAs proposed by members. We need the time to consult the LAB. So at the end of the day, there was no time for the bill to be considered. by this council, which is a pity. But we have made use of the time available to do something, and that is for the unlawful dismissal, unreasonable and unlawful dismissal. And if the labor tribunal so directs or so agrees, then reinstatement is allowed. If the employer is unwilling to reinstate the affected employee, then a compensation has to be given. The bill proposed a compensation of $50,000, but there was other suggestions, therefore necessitating the need to consult the LAB again. And during the interim, the LAB worked very hard to get a consensus, so it would increase from $50,000 to $72,500, and the employees, representatives and employers' representatives on the LAB reached this consensus. So apart from this change, we keep everything else. So the only change this time is about the compensation amount. I hope members would adopt a pragmatic approach. There are still 6 months to go for the current government. We'd like to enact and implement this new legislation to offer better protection to employees within the current term of government. I'm happy to answer questions on other details. It's a rather complicated bill. I don't want to waste time on those other parts of the bill. I believe members have read the paper. The floor is now open for questions. Four members would like to ask questions. Dr. Kwok Kah Kee, Mr. Poon Siew Peng, Mr. Kwok Wai Kung, and Mr. Poon Siew Peng. Dr. Kwok Kah Kee, Deputy Chairman, I think the biggest controversy is not about the compensation, but rather the right to reinstatement should be a right. It will change the compensation from $50,000 to $72,500. That's not a solution to the question of right to reinstatement. If it's a right for the employee, and if the employer doesn't comply, then there should be a higher fine, or you should make it a criminal offense. If the employer doesn't pay the additional compensation, it's a criminal offense. So if you say the employer has to pay $72,500, the deterrent is weak. I wouldn't say it's not a deterrent.
The biggest problem is that the employers are very irresponsible, especially in cases where the employees get injured at work. And these employees are often denied the right to be reinstated. And this is made a criminal offense in many countries worldwide. This is a right of the employee, and I'm disappointed that the government has not paid heed to suggestions of labor groups. You mentioned about the LAB all the time, but today we question whether the LAB can really reflect the views of the labor representatives, especially given the present election method and a few political parties are dominating or getting the seats in the LAB. So we can't count on the LAB. So here, once again, I would like to ask the Secretary, like what you said at the last session, you said that you would give up in certain circumstances the bill altogether. But then you know that the employees don't have the capability to ask for reinstatement and the compensation doesn't work for them. So how come that you are not drawing up a more deterrent penalty, say for example throwing the employers to prison, or come up with a heavier fine, say $150,000? Well, a fine of $72,000 is nothing at all to many employers. Dr. Kwok has the points made by Dr. Kwok has been discussed before. I will respond briefly, then I will ask my colleague, the Assistant Commissioner, to supplement. With regard to reinstatement, if the employers and employees have a sour relationship, and if you are forcing the employers to reinstate the employees, then that is not in the best interest of everyone. Do you think that can be done if the relationship is already soured? That is not practicable at all. That's not practicable. Even if the LT makes an RI order, one of the conditions is that it is it should be reasonably practicable. So the LT will consider whether the reinstatement is practical or reasonably practicable. So he would have regard to the relationship between the two parties and will look at all the objective factors before he makes a decision. And well, this is a third sum that the employer has to pay. The first sum is the terminal payment prescribed under the law. The second sum, well, in cases of UUD cases, there would be another sum which is in the form of compensation. And this further sum is a third sum that we are asking the employers to pay. So the employers do have pay out quite a substantial amount. So we have to be mindful of the affordability of the SMEs. If the compensation is too high, then it will pose difficulties to them. We have considered the bill for a long time, and regrettably, we couldn't work on it in the last session. So this time around, when we come back, we just want to deal with this change from $50,000 to $72,000. Next one, Mr. Pun Xiuping. Thank you, Chairman. Well, this bill has been discussed for a long time. This was first discussed at the LAB in 2007, and at the last term, the Legco discussed it. We only thought it could be passed, but ultimately didn't get passed. And the last time we were concerned about the amount, and the $50,000 is too small given to the inflation that we are seeing over the past 10 years. The LAB has come to a consensus of $72,500, and I respect that. And I hope that this bill can be passed as soon as possible with the electrical, so that we can protect the employees more. I have a question for the government. This is the amount that you are proposing, $72,500. If we have to adjust the amount, usually it will take a very long time. So what will be the review mechanism be like after the bill is enacted? Would you consider establishing a sort of a self-adjustment mechanism? Say, once every year or 2 years, based on the inflation rate and so on and so forth. Has the government considered that? Thank you, Mr. Poon, for your support. I hope that we can get the bill enacted within this session. There will be an additional provision. We will empower the Commissioner for Labour to have regard to the actual circumstances, and then, by way of a subsidiary legislation, revise the amount. So that's relatively simple. Well, that's similar to the mechanism mentioned in the earlier agenda item. So the Commissioner can, in the future, if he thinks that this amount is not sufficient, make the arrangement to adjust it upwards. He has the room to do it. That's part of the amendment. So will it be just the commissioner making the decision himself or what? Ms. Luk, please. Thank you, Chairman. Under the employment ordinance, there are different ceilings set. Say, for example, the compensation amount of $150,000, etc., etc. Well, this amount will be, that kind of amount will be adjusted or reviewed based on the actual economic situation of the society or the prevailing condition. So that's different from the statutory minimum wage. That has very much to do with livelihood. But for this kind of amount, so we're talking about a punitive amount and so on. So the consideration will be different. So it's even if we have a mechanism, it seems that we don't have a mechanism because we don't know under what conditions will you adjust the amount. Mr. Poon, is that what you think? Yes, I share the chairman's sentiment. You will have regard to the actual or the prevailing economic conditions. But then you should have a certain time frame in mind to do the review and adjustment of the amount. Then that would give better protection to the employees. Can you draw up a mechanism? Chairman, can I supplement a bit here? The beauty of the mechanism, if there is one, then it works in a simpler way. Of course, the Labor Department will do a detailed assessment, will study the different cases, and maybe we find that $72,000 is really not enough. We review labor legislation from time to time. Then if we want to review the mechanism, we can do it based on the amount that we have set now. Mr. Kotwei Kang, I have to tell the secretary here. The secretary just now emphasized that they couldn't do it in the last legislative session, so that's why we are having it discussed today. But then, in our previous discussions, we found that there is a major problem. In 2007-08, that was already decided upon by the LAB, but then the bill was also only introduced in 2015-16, and there has been a gap of 7 to 8 years, and you have not even included the inflation rate. So that's why we have a dispute on the amount here. So that was a premise of our discussion or controversy. So I hope that the administration and the Labor Department will make better calculations next time or in the future. Now, with regard to raising the amount from $50,000 to $72,500, that was a result after debates within the LAB. I believe that the LAB had protracted arguments on this already. They had a fight within the LAB, as far as I understand. But I really want this bill to be enacted as soon as possible. The ceiling of the first further sum makes a part of the bill, but I think the gist of the bill is that after the amendment, as long as the employer wishes to be reinstated, then the labor tribunal can make a reinstatement order, even without the consent of the employer. So that's represents a drastic change. The consent of the employer doesn't necessarily have to be obtained. And this is what I'm most concerned about. We've dealt with a lot of labor disputes in the past. And after disputes, the In many of the cases, the relationship between the two parties cannot be mended. And if that relationship can be not be mended, then the employees will be under a lot of pressure if he is reinstated. So if the reinstatement isn't possible, then he's paid a further sum, then I can accept that. So let's not procrastinate anymore. We've asked the administration, it's difficult to meet the criteria for reinstatement and also UUD. These are really rare cases, I would say. Let's not have unnecessary arguments over these matters. Let's have it passed as soon as possible, because it will represent a major step forward in terms of labor protection. So I hope that members can accept these amendments and get it passed as get them passed as soon as possible. I appreciate Mr. Kwok's pragmatic attitude. We try to be pragmatic. We hope that you can be accommodating and cooperative. We don't have much time left. If there is further amendment, we have to get it passed by the LAB. We won't be able to pass it within the session. Let's have it done first. And then if there are further inadequacies in the future, we can make further amendments in the future. So let's do that. Thank you, Chairman. Next one, Dr. Fernando Zhang. Of course, we support these amendments. Mr. Kwok highlights the gist of the amendments proposed. In the last term, Mr. Lee Chuk-yen suggested a further amendment. When the employers don't comply with the LT's reinstatement orders or re-engagement orders, the employee should have the right to take the case to the High Court so that these orders could be complied with and the employer can't refuse to comply. So we should not just settle for further sum of compensation. Maybe Mr. Kwok is not very clear-minded. Who? Well, as an employee, when he is has a confrontation with the employer and he is dismissed unreasonably, and he is given the RI order by the LT, and he still wants to be reinstated. Well, most employees would not want to be reinstated under that case. The possibility is that the employee holds a very important position with that company. And maybe that person is the leader of a labor union. Back then, I worked in the Polytechnic University. I was a representative of the staff of PolyU, and I sat on the board of the PolyU. Now, if I face a situation like what I mentioned, then I would really consider very seriously, say, if I lost this position, that would adversely impact the governance of that company. So that's why the employee was taking such a high risk and wished to be reinstated to the position. And the Mr. Lee Chuk-yen's proposed amendment is there to protect the leaders of the labor union, because this person holds an important position in the company and he wants very much to be reinstated. And after all, isn't this his right as well? Because the labor tribunal has issued the RI order or RE order, but then the employer doesn't comply with the order, and you allow him to get off with just paying $70,000. And by paying such a small sum, the employer, particularly, say, a very big company, the employer, then he can get off with paying that sum. So that's the loophole of the bill. And I'm asking you that the employer be given the right to take the case to the court. so that the order can be complied with.
And we should not allow the employer to get rid of, say, a trade union leader by paying $70,000. This is important. I hope political parties representing the labor sector will understand this is for the protection of union leaders. Well, maybe I can defer to Ms. Luk for a response. Thank you, Chairman, and I thank Dr. Jiang for his views. Last time at the Bills Committee, we already had a discussion. Well, there is a certain valid argument in the point made, but we need to look at it from another angle. The entire reinstatement arrangement is really about giving recognition to the dignity of the employee. It's more about showing respect for the dignity of the employee. The court will have to consider many factors. If we do something that will lead to a very tense labor relationship in the workplace, then the court will have to consider a number of related factors. But in March and April, we had many rounds of discussion about this. But we want to be pragmatic about this. If the majority of cases on a reinstatement are like this, then we need to go for a pragmatic resolution. The legislative proposal is to enable the employee to right the wronged employee through a call order, and that the court is of the view that the employee should be reinstated. But if the employer thinks that, that there's no room to work with the employee, then the current proposal in the bill would be a pragmatic way out. Not that Dr. Fernando Zhang's proposal is wrong. The employee's concern may be under different circumstances. Some may have suffered from injury at work, but what we're proposing is pragmatic. Well, mine is also pragmatic. The amendment previously moved by Mr. Lee Chuck Yan would give an additional avenue to the affected employee. The employee can choose to receive the compensation. We just want that another channel be allowed for a trade union leader to get justice. If we do not do this, how can we protect union leaders and the trade unions? We want to protect workers who are dismissed unreasonably. And if the employee wants to be reinstated and the employer says no, and we allow the matter to be resolved through a payment of compensation. We understand the point that this relationship may have broken down, but we have to protect those who had to be reinstated for some other reasons. For example, union leaders. So we are concerned that the protection for union leaders can be somehow cancelled through payment. The points are taken. When we presented the proposals at the LAB, it was very tough. It was very tough for the employers to convince the employees and the employees to convince the employers. If we want to subject unreasonable and unlawful dismissal cases to mandatory reinstatement or re-engagement order, and if we were to add one additional redress, then it's difficult to have the employers agreeing. So that's the proposals are the best we can achieve at the moment. So in their eyes, that's a balanced way out. Well, this is by no means a balanced one. Only very rarely would the labor tribunal grant a reinstatement order. The current proposals are favoring the employers. Mr. Tamman Ho. He said that the compensation would be like 3 months' wages. It's $50,000, it's $24,000 per month, or if there's one additional month of bonus, it's $20,000 plus. So very easily, the upper limit will be exceeded. Even for the middle class employee, the limit will be exceeded carefully. There was a suggestion on of setting the level at a 6 months of salary or $100,000, is that the employer may find it difficult to afford. If a company hires an employee who's paid $50,000 a month, then we're not talking about a small company, and as the limit of $72,500 is not adequate. If we want to protect union leaders, let's say we agree that this should be enacted first, then what else can be done to protect union leaders from unlawful or unreasonable dismissal? Secretary or Ms. Luk? Well, we are talking about, in this case, unlawful dismissal. The wrongful act itself is punishable under law, criminally. And then we say that in respect of the civil remedy, what can be done to the injured party? And we are talking about five scenarios of unlawful dismissal. For those five scenarios, there are already other remedies under law. So in other words, there's no additional safeguard afforded to union leaders. We are talking about five cases of unreasonable and unlawful dismissal. Whether the affected employee is a union leader or not, they are protected to the same extent. You'd say this is really about the gesture of showing or restoring the respect. So it brings me back to the same question. How can we protect union leaders? Let's say this bill is enacted because we want to be pragmatic. Are there other laws, or are you going to amend other laws to protect union leaders? Ms. Luk, under the existing employment ordinance, there are already provisions to protect against these five situations of unlawful dismissal. And the protection for the affected employee is the compensation. If it's one of the five situations for on unlawful dismissal, then the employee can ask for an additional compensation from the employer by taking the case to the labor tribunal. So is my understanding correct? What it takes is that the employee is required to pay 72,500. But the bill is drafted like this. When it's judged that it's ruled that the employee should be reinstated, and in order to save the time of the employee. How can you save the time of the employee? But there's a concern that if there's a reinstatement order, but the employer refuses to reinstate the employee, the employee would be given 72,500. But what about other entitlements? So apart from reinstatement, and if this is not done, the employee will get not just the 72,500, and the employee is also entitled to ask for termination payment for if a union leader vis-a-vis a non-union leader who has been dismissed under the same situation, they would get the same compensation. No. But if it's, it arises from union activities, of course, the employer will not admit that is related to union activities. Let's say Mr. Lau Siu Lai and I myself, one of us is a union leader, but one is not. If I receive the same monthly pay as she, will we be getting the same compensation? What if the employee is dismissed on the basis of union activities? The affected union leader can go to the court to seek compensation, which can be as much as $150,000 up to. But the compensation is not paid only to union leaders. I think my understanding is correct. It doesn't take a union leader to apply for additional compensation.
Not everyone can apply for this compensation. It's not just in the employment ordinance, there are five circumstances where there are unreasonable dismissal, including dismissal during pregnancy and so on and so forth. So there are five scenarios. Now, the discrimination against you being a union leader is one of the circumstances. Mr. Ho, in the past 5 years, how many cases are there in the RI cases? How many cases are UUD cases? What is the present situation like? Mr. Luk, every year for UUD cases and also request for reinstatement cases, for the latter case, every year we received 3 to 4 such cases asking for reinstatement. And also, these are also UUD cases. And or only UUD every year? Well, such cases take up 1.8% of all the cases we receive. 3 to 4 cases have to do with RI orders. Then I don't see why the LAB has to have such a discussion on this. Only a very unscrupulous employer will be caught under this $72,000 scheme. So, Secretary, would you be reviewing this amount, say, in 1 to 2 years' time? Because we're talking a very talking about a very small number of cases, 3 to 4 every year, and it will not pose extra heavy burden on employers. So can you undertake when you will do a review? And it's difficult to prove that an employer is dismissing a person or employee because he is discriminating against a union leader. Can you make clearer provisions in your amendments? The employer has to do a lot to prove that he is being dismissed because he is a union leader and is being discriminated against. So the burden of proof is very high. But then, indeed, there are so many cases where the employees are working in a trade union and he's asking, has a lot of requests to raise for the employer and he's being dismissed. So do we have a timetable on when you review provisions relating to discrimination against the union leaders? I agree that we should pass this bill as soon as possible because it gives better protection. But then still, I would like to know when you will review this amount and also when you review the provisions relating to discrimination against union leaders. So let's enact the bill as soon as possible, so that we can monitor the situation and identify any flaws. And then maybe we'll spend 2 years monitoring the situation, and then we can do a review. Because we're talking just about 3 to 4 cases every year. Maybe one case is related to a union leader. He is unreasonably dismissed. Then we can look at this case, and then we'll try to do a review based on that. Well, the discussion here is very theoretical now, but then let's have some real experience. And of course, we'll have to have regard to the operation of the SMEs for whatever we do. Let's be prudent, let's be pragmatic first. So an addition of $22,500 doesn't come easily. Well, 75% of the employees in Hong Kong will be covered under the amendment bill. So let's pass this as soon as possible so that we can do a review as early as possible. Do you have a timetable on the review? Well, if the commissioner doesn't object, maybe we can do the review in 2 years' time. We can then look at the data and look at the operational experience in those 2 years, and we can study the cases one by one, and then we can do a review. Would you also be reviewing the legislation on discrimination against trade union and union leaders? Well, as what the commissioner says, we are reviewing our laws from time to time. And if there are indeed flaws in that other piece of legislation, we can review them at one go. There are only 2 to 3 cases relating to reinstatement. Do you have information on the kind of organizations involved? Large organization or SMEs? I don't have the specific information on hand. But what are these specific cases? Among the 3 cases I received every year, from the experience in the past decade or so, we can see that after our mediation, about 30 to 40% of the cases have been resolved. And we have a breakdown on these figures. Three cases have to do with pregnancy, three cases paid sick leave, and some cases work-related injuries. So, going by the nature of these cases, I would suspect that there are many SMEs involved. Well, for a company with an HRD department, they will not commit such silly mistakes. Well, I'm talking about cases on RI, yes. But they are asking for reinstatement, yes. These are cases relating to reinstatement. Next one, Mr. Xiu Ka-chun. Secretary said that he's said all the time that he's pragmatic, but I have a question on, say, concepts. Unreasonable dismissal. There are five scenarios. Dismissal during pregnancy, during paid sick leave, trade unions, leaders, and so on. On the concept of unreasonable dismissal, can we cover more circumstances under that heading? Say, for example, discrimination against political orientation, sexual orientation, etc., etc., so that employees will not be casually dismissed because they have hold different views from the employer in those areas. We note the members' concern, but I would like to say that whether additional areas that should be covered under this unreasonable dismissal, that falls outside the scope of the present exercise. In the present employment ordinance, I would say the scope under unreasonable and illegal dismissal is rather constrained. If we say that dismissal is unlawful, we have to be very careful in using that term. Now, the interpretation is relatively simple. But then if you talk about unlawful dismissal, that's altogether a different concept. Well, even if there are disputes, you cannot dismiss the person because the dismissal may be unlawful. So the scope is rather narrow or constrained. So unlawful dismissal covers dismissal during pregnancy, during paid sick leave, after work-related injury and taking of a sick leave. And say if the employee give information on the employer's breaching certain employment ordinance, say if the employee reports on the employers breaching certain laws, employment laws. So we are, the scope is rather narrow. But then what you mentioned may be very controversial. And given the present situation, I don't think we would cover that. So Mr. Xu, I don't know why it can't be done. Why do you have to be so constrained or narrow? My criticism exactly on that is too narrow, the scope. Well, I have handled a number of complaints, the employers being given a difficult time or even dismissed because of they have just different sexual orientation. And after the umbrella movement, employees are being challenged or given difficulties because they have different political views from their employers. So this is what is happening after the umbrella movement. So why can't you widen the scope? Would you consider it, Mr. Luk? Well, we can consider all sorts of things if we are taking the perspective of protection, protecting the rights of the employees, but then we still have to take on the perspective of the employers. And also secondly, can we come up with very clear parameters on those things? Some members mentioned that we are doing very badly in terms of the discrimination against trade union leaders. But then for the unlawful dismissal, the five scenarios under the law now are quite clear-cut. But then if you talk about discrimination issues, then we need a lot of more proof to prove a certain case or to substantiate a case. Well, it's easier if we talk about, say, trade union leaders, and they will tell people that they are union leaders. But then if we talk about other spheres, like what you mentioned, there will be a lot of disputes. And also it's very difficult to delineate the parameters. It will not be easy if we want to have criminal prosecution. Now, if we want to write something into the law, we have to be very clear in our terms. And for example, work-related injury, pregnancy, these are very clear-cut cases. People should be, or employees should be protected. Again, the same applies to trade union activities. These are all clear-cut cases. It's easier to produce proof in the court. But then if you talk about attitudes and so on, it's very difficult. It's difficult to write those in the law, or else or it would also make it the judges difficult, life difficult for the judges. And it's also difficult for the DOJ to write all those things into the law. I'm sure that we would come back to you for a discussion on these issues or matters. There are two members who yet want to speak. I will have to extend the meeting for at least 10 minutes. Next one, Mr. Andrew Wen. Thank you, Chairman. I have a follow-up question to Mr. Xu's question. I'm not happy with the answer. We talk about unlawful dismissal and unreasonable dismissal. The employees are entitled to RI and RE. But after the amendment, you are just covering the unlawful dismissal. And the Secretary has given us the rationale just now. But then how do you define unreasonable dismissal now? On the surface, the amendment seems to provide for a higher compensation level, and then also the employer's consent doesn't need to be obtained for RI and RE. But then it in effect represents a step backward, because you are taking away the unreasonable element from the amendment. So I find it weird. How come that you say that let it pass first because it represents a major step forward? And the Secretary said that it's very difficult to define unreasonable and unlawful dismissal.
Well, unlawful dismissal is easier to define, but it doesn't mean that we can do nothing about unreasonable dismissal. Maybe Mr. Wen is not aware of what we discussed last time. This time, the only change is about the compensation, 72,500. We haven't changed even a comma or dot. Members who are not from the labor sector may not know much about the background. We are talking about a situation whereby it's both unreasonable and unlawful. But this is not a retrogressive step. Well, no. We have not departed from anything that we discussed last time. The bill it will be reintroduced as it was, with the exception of the amount of compensation. I think by saying that it's retrogressive, the member is saying that you would allow the unreasonable dismissal to be treated more leniently. So are you only going to cover the unlawful dismissal, and then unreasonable dismissal is not? Why do we want to provide for mandatory reinstatement for unreasonable and unlawful dismissal? So we're saying that the dismissal is both unreasonable and against the labor legislation. So the employer commits an offense due to the dismissal. So that's why we say there should be a reinstatement order. Well, I think they have already said what's meant by unreasonable and unlawful dismissal. It refers to a situation where an employee is dismissed other than a valid reason as specified under the EO. So he who has money can dismiss the employee in a summary fashion by just paying the compensation. And the price to pay is so cheap. This time you have raised the compensation amount. You think this is good enough? Well, you can increase the compensation so that the employer would feel the sting. And you're saying that it should be pegged at 3 months of a salary, but the upper limit should be 72,500. As I've said time and again, if you park your car illegally in Central, well, the chauffeur holds a wad of bank notes and will tell the police that my boss is rich. There's no criminal liability if the employer pays the money. And if you say that failure to comply is a criminal offense, and a criminal offense has to be proved to the fullest possible extent. And the lawyer representing the employer can argue against it. Why is it that making the payments would absolve the employer from his criminal liability? And also you want to disqualify 4 members. You are trying to change the electoral results. It's so shameless. In the future, civil servants, employees employed by the statutory bodies, if they disagree with the government, if they join protests, or if they put up a poster saying that it's not right to disqualify Leung Kok Hong and the other members, and then they are dismissed. Disqualification is a serious matter constitutionally, and you still dare to do it. So what Mr. Siu Ka-chun has said will not be something for the distant future. It's like the Cultural Revolution. You rat on people. A person use a piece of newspaper carried with the photo of Mao Zedong, and there was an informer telling the authority about that, and the person was subsequently executed. In the last term, we had a discussion, and then there was some discussion at the LAB, and now the amount has increased to 72,500. Both the employers and the employees think that the employer shouldn't do this. But if this is awarded by the court and the employer refuses to reinstate the employee, then he has to pay 3rd time. There are criminal penalty for non-compliance. Well, defying a court order is always criminal. If I refuse to comply with a court order, of course, it's a criminal offense. Well, the refusal itself should be a criminal offense. It should be punishable by either fine or imprisonment. Now you specify an amount, and only refusal to pay the compensation is a criminal offense. You're trying to switch the principles behind. Mr. Look, I have to give you 1 minute, and I won't be able to speak. Although many members have left, I know we all have our ideals, but this council should be responsible. We should take a step, one step at a time. That's what I mean by being pragmatic. If we don't do what should be done, then we are to blame. If nothing is changed, there's no reinstatement order for the time being, unless the employer agrees to reinstate the employee. And with the new bill enacted, the employee can seek to have a reinstatement granted in his favor. So, Chairman, I think you should lead all of us in making a rational decision. I think that's the end of this agenda, of the discussion on this agenda item. When are you going to table the bill, Secretary? If members want to express further views, that would have to be done at the Bills Committee. It's only 4 to 5 months only before the end of this current government. Well, I can agree to to a discussion at the Bills Committee. If there's any amendment, we'll have to go back to the LAB, and then you know there are new members at the LAB. I don't want to have this bill aborted. I think the unions are not just concerned, are not mainly concerned about the compensation. They are also concerned about protection for union leaders. Well, we can review the situation 2 years down the road. It would be better if there's no Bills Committees. We can join the queue earlier, and then the bill can be enacted earlier. Well, let's see when you can table the bill, and we'll see if a Bills Committee is needed. Thank you for coming. Meeting's adjourned.